Hello and welcome to Wrestling and Everything Coast to Coast. This time, Mark Two with now with guests JJ Purdom, co-host Evan Ginsberg, and we should have Casey Wood, Kid Chrome, on here in a minute or two if we can patch him in. So thank you guys for being post last minute additions to tonight's show, and really appreciate having you. And I know it's getting later over there, so wanted to just get to some of the topics at hand. We're gonna do like a full on memorial of Terry Funk and Bray Wyatt next week, but what I really want to know about is your reaction to the news for both of you.
Let me start with Terry Funk was one of my heroes, and it was rough hearing the news, but at the same time, he had the beginnings of Alzheimer's, and in which case it was merciful, you know, not to drag on for long drawn out painful deterioration. And there was several times Dr. Mike and myself had discussed, you know, bringing him on, interviewing him, and Mike would say, you know, the family's preferring not to put him on the air because his memory wasn't what it was, and he had his good days and his bad days. So, you know, in a case like that, you know, it's terribly sad because the guy was on my Mount Rushmore. I saw him live against Jerry Lawler. I was there for the legendary I Quit match with Ric Flair. I saw him with Cactus Jack, Sabu. Believe it or not, I did not see him in his NWA heyday as world champion because, you know, as a lifelong New Yorker, he just was not here really until, except for a couple of spot appearances like Madison Square Garden when they bring the NWA guys in. He didn't really come in until the 80s when he was feuding with Junkyard Dog. And, it was interesting because he was technically past his prime even then, and he just went on for another 20 years having great matches. You know, he knew how to, change with the times and change his style, and bad knees and all. The guy was just phenomenal, and he put over everybody that he was in the ring with. He made them look like $1 million. I don't want to hog the airtime here, but just one of my top five all-time favorites, and so was Billy Graham. And Lanny Poffo was a dear friend. So it was just a very hard year. Very hard year as far as losing your wrestling heroes and friends.
And the Iron Sheik, too, you know, was a big part of the 80s. Yeah. You know, that mid-80s period when wrestling was so huge.
Oh, yeah.
For me, I'm going to agree with Evan. Everything that Terry Funk touched turned to gold. I was the biggest Terry Funk fan. I can easily say, like a lot of people like to throw the term GOAT around, the greatest of all time. I think that Terry Funk was the GOAT. He was the best that ever did it. Everywhere he went, he made people look better. He drew houses. He was an incredible promo. All the guys looked up to him. You remember back when he was doing WWE during the Attitude Era, they were all saying that he was 53 and crazy. And, you know, man, he lived to 79. So that's a life well lived, if I do say so myself. And I think, yeah, if I can make it to 79, I'll be very happy. And I haven't done a thimbleful of what Terry Funk did.
79 is like dog years in wrestling. Nikolai Volkoff, who was a health nut, he didn't make 79. And if somebody had asked me 10 years ago to make a bet, you know, would Nikolai outlive the Iron Sheik, I would have taken that bet and lost. So you never know with these things. But Yeah, the Iron Sheik, when he was in his prime, I saw him at the Garden one night. He wins a battle royale, and then he goes 30 minutes with Backlund. The guy was a machine in his prime. And him and Slaughter with those boot camp matches, it was unbelievable.
By the way, Sergeant Slaughter just turned 75 today. I don't know if a lot of, you know, it's good to know that at least he's one of the legends that has hung on. It still looks pretty good for being 75, so a shout
prime
out.
Prime Slaughter, 1980 to 85, WWWF, WWF. The guy was unbelievable. Unbelievable.
By the way, I wanted to welcome in Casey Wood, better known as Kid Chrome from APW, and I don't think you've done the show yet with Evan. I'm not sure you've done it with JJ either.
I have not. Nice to meet you guys.
Nice to meet you.
JJ, you and Kid Chrome kind of passed in the night, I think.
Yeah, I think I got to APW and the like shortly after Kid Chrome was not in the area any longer. And it's my bad that I didn't get to be there around him, because I've heard nothing but good things.
Yeah, so, that's cool, so we have a real quorum here tonight. You know, that's one thing, though, is that Terry Funk did not wrestle that often in Northern California. I'm trying to think of like when he was on any cards that were out in NorCal while, you know, I was growing up. Or, I mean, because the NWA really didn't fight, you know, the AWA was the ruling territory for the most part in that mid-80s time frame, you know, early 80s to mid-80s time frame.
Well, I'm sure as NWA champ, he had a role into Roy Shire's territory just to defend the belt, but that's 10 years earlier or whatnot.
Yeah, and it might have been before I was really, you know, able to see any. But when he was at his biggest, you know, and, you know, really challenging for, you know, being a part of, you know, with, you know, the Dory Funk Jr. tag stuff and all that stuff. That was much more concentrated to the South. And he probably didn't even come into New York all that often, or up to Portland in that sense. You know, he didn't. So that, I think that was one thing, is he was, you know, still part of when regional wrestling was such a big thing. But he wasn't the star on the level of, like, say, you know, other guys like obviously Hulk Hogan or so forth that, you know, had the benefit of being really recognized worldwide as a wrestling champion. But
well,
I don't think
as NWA champion, he went everywhere, literally around the world. But it was a strain on the marriage, like many of these guys. The NWA champion, you know, had a grueling schedule. So eventually he wanted to give that up to spend more time at home. So, exactly. Which is to his credit, you know.
I would say that the heel run that he had with Flair in 89, after Flair got his sixth title off of Ricky Steamboat, and when he comes in and asks for a title match, and Flair tells him, you know, you've been in Hollywood for the last 5 years. You don't deserve a shot. Get in line. It's honestly one of the best angles of all time. I know it really pissed off Ricky Steamboat because he wasn't smart enough to, hey, they're going to run an angle right after this incredible match that you guys have. And man, that whole run with the I Quit match and everything else with Funk, I took awesome. That guy believable because he was crazy. He was legitimately crazy. And that's where I fell in love with Terry Funk. And where I put that stamp on him, he is the GOAT, man.
Well, the thing with Terry Funk is when he was in the ring, you know, he was doing a ton of improv. You know, he wasn't one of these guys who sat down and knew move for move what he was going to do. You know, he was reacting. He was an improvisational genius, that guy. And, man, I saw him one day in a barbed wire match with Sabu. It was crazy. Great. Yeah.
And maybe he doesn't make my Mount Rushmore the greatest of all time. He makes Mount Rushmore as toughest of all time. I think legitimately Terry Funk was as tough as you can get and still not actually die in the ring. In fact, I was saying on the other recording that we were doing before you guys joined in, with Beyond the Mat, you know, and that was 25 years ago. The doctor was saying, how can you, like, how come you're not dead already, basically, you know, looking at all the injuries that he's had. And it's like, you're basically held together by scar tissue. That's the only thing that's holding you right now, you know.
Mick Foley did a beautiful tribute to him, really, from the heart. And he said that Terry Funk was in so much pain before certain matches, you know, he was amazed that the guy actually went through with it. And, you know, the matches were great. Great. So, you know, let me just say one thing about this guy. You know, wrestling is such a dirty business that no matter who you talk about, you have the fans and the detractors. Okay. Terry Funk died. It was just like this universal mourning, respect, you know, love, yeah, appreciation. You know, you're not going to get this with everybody. You know, when Hulk Hogan dies, you know, you could say he's more famous, but that's a controversial figure, you know. Like Terry Funk, it was just love, man, love. And, you know, some of the best nights of my life was seeing that guy. And, you know, it hurts when your childhood heroes are gone, you know, one after another.
Yeah, and, you know, just, I mean, so your favorite match was the I Quit match, you feel?
Oh, yeah, yeah. My favorite that I saw live, but I saw him with Eddie Gilbert and, like I said before, Lawler. He used to come down to Philly for Joe Goodhart's Tri-State, and he would headline Terry Funk, and they were amazing, amazing matches. And that was early 90s, so he was still, you know, I wouldn't say young, but youngish, and the guy was still great. Yeah.
Casey, some of your thoughts about Terry Funk.
Well, what do you say? I mean, it was just amazing to me how he could just adjust to any style, you know, like his, from like Japan was completely different, obviously, than ECW or WCW or, you know, the NWA days. Like somebody was saying earlier, where you could just ad-lib things, you know, on the fly, go out there and just be what he needed to be at the time, wild and crazy, or just, you never knew what you're going to get, you know. You'd be calm and all cool and then just flip, you know.
And he was great on the mic. He was just fantastic on the mic.
Yeah, he could put over any angle just by, you know, being Terry Funk without a gimmick. You know,
and he knew how to work with people from pretty much Japan, as you said, Japan, and from Mexico, and from, you know, England. And if he had to do a technical match, you know, he could wrestle technically.
Hardcore, technical, whatever what needed to be done, he could do it.
And he didn't mind taking a ton of punishment on the way.
No, not at all. Obviously.
Punishment. Those Onita matches, blowing the guy up. It was crazy.
No
crazy.
Kidding. Yeah, there's that too. The death matches are nuts.
Yeah.
Somehow, unfortunately, we lost JJ. There must be some kind of interference there. But let's, if you would like to, you know, talk now about Bray Wyatt and the shock of his passing.
Okay, as you know, I'm not the world's biggest WWE fan, but I was and am a Bray Wyatt fan. I saw Bray Wyatt headline Madison Square Garden against John Cena, and they tore the place up. Place was packed. The fans, this is 2017, the fans were totally, totally into Bray Wyatt's gimmick. He was totally over. And the very next show that they had was Bray Wyatt and Roman Reigns headlining the Garden, and it was also a great match. So the first match, Bray Wyatt pinned Cena at the Garden, and the next match, Reigns pinned Bray. But my point being, you know, this guy was on top. This he had a unique gimmick, and for whatever reason, the next time I saw him at the Garden, he was in the opening match. And I'm like, oh, I don't know how he got from the good list to the bad list or whatnot. Wow, but it was bizarre. Yeah, it was bizarre. And then they had that ridiculous Fiend gimmick, and it became sort of cartoonish. But when he was doing Bray Wyatt circa 2017, I mean, this guy was the world champion. I mean, he was. Yeah. And I'll tell you another real quick story. Down at the Queen's Elks Lodge, where they used to run the ECW shows, they had a little indie show. And he was on the show before he was Bray Wyatt. I forget what his name was at the time, but
for fans who are watching this, we were originally slated to have Ryan and Ellie be part of the podcast, and things didn't work out yesterday, and then my podcast got discontinued because the cable went out during the podcast. So for everyone, they watch the first 15 minutes and it's going, what the hell is going on? This is the most unusual show that we've done, but it should still be a lot of fun for everyone. So we've got Lex Devine, not Ryan. I shouldn't call you Ryan, or should I call you Lex now?
I mean, this is sort of a kayfabe breaking podcast, right? So
yeah. I mean, we're sitting next to each other on a couch, and in kayfabe, the most interaction we've ever had is him reading bullying tweets to me in front of a crowd.
Okay.
So we're not together and are not like living together in kayfabe. So.
Right, in the wrestling world. That's okay. So I'm supposed to be Italian, so you know, and I'll have spaghetti tonight, but that's about the only thing about me that's actually Italian. Don't tell Monty from Monty and the Pharaoh. He gets so upset at that. For some reason, Monty from Monty and the Pharaoh thinks that like my pretending that I was Italian is like the most offensive thing that's ever happened in the history of wrestling. And the fact that, you know, from probably 1940 to like 19 to the early 2020s, you know, everybody has had variety of characters. Like Roddy Piper was not from Scotland, you know, right. Kind of thing. And Sergeant Slaughter wasn't in the actual military, and other stuff like that. So, you know, people and even the and one of our topics for tonight, which is the passing of exotic Adrian Street. He wasn't, you know, actually homosexual, but, you know, that's what he did in the ring. So, you know, so that does bring us to some of our topics for tonight is actually, you know, the career of exotic Adrian Street. And since you guys are part of Full Queer Wrestling, and I said it right, I didn't say totally queer this time. I said full queer. So not fully, but full. Yes. No, I'm not. Well, as soon as you said it was a parody of Full Gear, not a parody, but sort of a you know, tip to the hat, tribute. Yeah. To Full Gear Wrestling, you know, then I kind of got that. So you guys had a show not too long ago, maybe about a month and a half ago, probably.
It was actually just 2 weeks ago now.
Yeah, our most recent show was August 13th.
Oh, it was August 13th. Okay. I was out of town, but how did that go for you guys?
The show really went swimmingly. It was Ellie's singles debut. She wrestled El Chupacabra.
He's an old friend of mine.
Yeah.
Chupi is an old friend of mine. Yeah, he worked for us at California Championship Wrestling. And, you know, he might be slowing down a little bit, but he's one of my favorite guys to watch in the ring.
If this is him slowed down, I'm just glad that my path intersects his at this exact moment, because I feel like he really trusted me. He worked really well with me because I am so green. He was very concerned with what I could do, what I like to do, what made sense for our characters, and he really walked me through all of that. But also, like, dude can go. I definitely felt like I was being pushed, like, to the limits of my abilities a lot of the time, so that was really cool.
Well, I had the pleasure of watching him up against Virgil Flynn a bunch of times, you know, the late Virgil, and those were, considering, you know, we were just a bunch of indie folks all watching a show, I was like, this isn't an indie show. These aren't two indie guys we're watching. We're watching two professional guys that are in the indies, but we're not watching two indie guys going there. And also when he would have his matches up against Tim Thatcher, you know, you're saying to yourself, and to be honest with you, I'm really amazed that Chuppy never really got a big call in to the WWE or AEW now. Even now, I think he would work well with AEW and their smaller wrestlers. And for some reason, him and a couple other guys, but you know him, he was one of the guys that I really surprised. And like Oliver John, like never got like a really good, you know, call up from the indies to spend their time in the pros, because those are just great guys in the ring. So you fought Chuppy. Who won?
Chuppy.
Okay, good.
better. He hit me with his version of the code red, and I was not prepared.
Uh-huh.
So he pinned me for three. But you know, I got some stuff in. I got some tackles in. I speared him.
Nice.
I have only ever done that in practice matches before, and I love the spear. So I hope to get even better at it. Really make it my own.
Nice. Do you have a name for it? Do you have a name for your spear move?
At this point, I've got a couple ideas, but I feel like, as a green person, it would be kind of silly to name like moves that I'm not sure are going to become part of my core moves. I have a couple that I definitely do. Like I do the Mark Henry Strongest Slam, and I call it the World's Strongest Slam Burger. Kind of like a fast food reference. I do plan on having like burger themed stuff later.
Nice. Okay. I like that.
The spear has got to be a core move for you.
Probably.
Maybe you could throw pickles into the audience.
The pickle spear?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The kosher pickle spear.
The kosher pickle spear. I love it.
That's what I do. That's what managers do. You come up with gimmicky names for people. You gotta
have a better name for my other favorite move to do. I didn't get to do this against Chuppy, and I hope to show it off maybe at the next match that I'm in. But I do the like corner to corner flipping neck breaker that Mr. Perfect did. And yeah. I've been calling it the flipper doozle because one of my classmates, when we were trying to call a match together, she was just like, yeah, you know, and then you can do your thing, the thing with the flipper doozle. And I'm like, well, that's that, but it's kind of a placeholder name until we think of something
better. It's not burger. It's not. You know, maybe it's like, say, you know, something like the maybe like the spatula or something like that, you know.
Burger flip.
Yes. Maybe, you know, if you're really, you know, wanting to go retro, you could come out to the theme of Burger Time, the video game. Now that would really, the people who have been in the business for a while would get that.
Strong option, but this same friend, who also I should shout out because she might be watching this, referee Domino, student of Stoner U, she went on Spotify and like the first result, if you look up burger, is this very weird beatboxing remix thing that goes hamburger, hamburger, cheeseburger, hamburger, cheeseburger, Big Mac, Whopper. And I don't know like what kind of universal forces had to align for me to discover this song this way, but I do think that maybe it would be a fun thing to come out
better with. You could get the crowd to start, you know, you could try to get the crowd to get you know, a chant for you going Whopper, 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 you know, kind of.
It would be a great gimmick for me to be like, she's a Whoppa.
Yes, or that maybe that's what your finishing thing could be, you know, the double Whopper with cheese kind of thing, you know.
I love like it.
With jalapenos. So Ryan, how was your show? How did the show go for you?
Oh, it went great. I debuted a new managing persona, which I think is sort of half of a new character, because it's, I think, something that Lex Devine puts on, which is a wizard lawyer character named Lothar the Objectionable.
Wow.
And I represented briefly Doc Atrocity and then later the team of Night Court, which is Jekyll's the Freak and Dave Reckoning.
Wow, you guys are working with some great people. You're working with some great people. I mean, Jekyll's is another one of my favorite guys to watch do the show. And
same.
There was a moment when I had to grab the microphone and vamp because somebody wasn't ready for a cue, but that went swimmingly. Then later we worked an angle, me and Ellie, where it was a vignette, I guess, where I announced our new anti-bullying policy, which is a list of mean tweets that people have sent about Ellie. And I just read the tweets verbatim and talked about how bad they were. And
how bad were the tweets?
They're very funny.
It was
really interesting for me too, because I, you know, he announced me, I entered, I did my whole entrance thing, got to, you know, do a solo entrance for a real match for the first time. Yes. Awesome. So high energy. And then he reads a tweet where somebody says, remember that perky girl that worked at Express? Well, if she had a wrestling career, that's LED. Something to that effect.
Yes.
Like, I can't even shop at Express. I don't make my size.
Yeah.
What the heck? But so that was really funny. His HR assistant, Gutsy Gillespie,
They're not my HR assistant. They're just my assistant.
Okay, well, they're...
I'm the HR.
Yeah.
They tried to dissuade him from what happened, but it was fine. Then he brought in Chupacabra, who immediately tried to pick a fight with a dog.
Yes, there was a very beautiful dog at ringside.
I think we're gonna have to work an angle with the dog.
That absolutely. Although
was this the green thing?
No, this was a little fluffy terrier mix looking thing. Really cute dog. The lady who brought the dog later came up to me and said clearly the dog was my biggest fan because the dog really wanted me to be Chupacabra after their interaction. Maybe now, next time, puppy.
If you could find like a stuffed dog to like look like that dog, you could like do some kind of funny move in the ring, you know, pretend to steal the dog, put it in the ring, and then do some kind of crazy move to it, you know. And then obviously, then the lady would bring the dog back out to know that no actual dogs were harmed. I'm not for any kind of dog, person to dog violence, but
it wouldn't be the first stuffed animal in one of our rings, and it won't be the last.
Yes.
Yeah, no, we actually had a trios match featuring Steve the Cat, which is a stuffed cat character that you may have been aware of previously, perhaps.
Steve works with Joey Smoke and Brittany Wonder.
Yeah, that's right. And
Together
they are the Wonder Cats, is it?
Yes, the Wonder Cats.
I have to bring my Leopardo Loco character out of retirement. Not me personally, but Steve Smart, who used to wrestle a long time ago. He needed a character at the last minute because he was on the show twice. We needed to fill in for somebody, so he went up.
What happened with the Balthazar gimmick, kind of?
Yeah, and so we threw a mask on Steve, and I told him just act like a cat in the ring. And he went up against Christina Von Eerie. And she had a cat toy. We got a cat toy at the dollar store. And so the finish was that she would take this cat toy out, and instead of wrestling, he would, like, bat it with his hands and stuff like that. And she, like, spun the cat toy around and around and around. He got so dizzy, he fell over, and she pinned him. So That was kind of fun. So, as I said, I'll get Leopard. If we're going to go the cat theme, I'll get Leopard a loco out of retirement. He can join me.
For sure.
Christina, by the way, is confirmed booked for our next show.
That's true.
If you want to come see her, she'll be on our next show, which is in September.
Yes. It's
the Folsom Street Fair.
Oh, yeah. No, I want to go to that. I definitely want to be there for that. I mean, I'm glad I was able to make your other show, but then August 13th, I was out of town. So, you know, were you over at the brewery that you normally have your shows at? The 13th?
October, so.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
but before that is Folsom.
Okay. But are you beginning to make that Armistice Brewery your go-to spot as far as your regular place? It's good. It's good to have a place that you can do shows at reliably, and that
yeah.
You know they're really happy to have you there at the on the grounds and everything.
I think so.
You bring in some good business for them.
We've been told that we provide a very significant sales boost to Armistice. So we can definitely help them out business-wise. And, you know, they help us out by letting us do our show there for free. They don't charge us anything to produce the show there.
That is a big plus. And again, you know, if you do it when you do it, which is during, you know, the daytime on a Sunday or a Saturday, then you're not going to get noise complaints or, you know, fire code violations or the kind of things that, you know, a lot of places that try to do underground stuff that tries to do stuff in warehouses and things like that without zoning it or anything like that. That's much better for you guys. So I'm glad about that.
Though we have looked into some more underground warehousey locations. So you may hear about us producing a show at a venue like that soon.
We're always open to hearing from venues that want to host us, by the way. If anybody with a venue is listening.
That's always the biggest thing. Yeah, I'm sure you'd love to have a place where you could store the ring and, you know, your other stuff and not have to move it. People don't understand, like, how much effort it is to set up a ring in a different location. I mean, yes, the rings are made to be set up in another location, but it means that you're like taking out a half day, you know, probably the day before to get out there and set everything up, or you have to get there super early, even for like an 8 o'clock show.
And now we're renting other people's rings. So the expense that comes with that, and then we pay the ring crew.
It's maybe not as bad time-wise as you think. We start set up a few hours before the show, but the ring setup, takes, 90 minutes at most.
Yeah.
Which is not that bad. And so while it is an expense for us to have to rent the ring every time, we do get to support other local wrestling companies along the way because they're happy to provide their ring and the ring crew. And then usually their students are the ring crew. And since they're around, we often wind up putting them on shows when people no show on us and that sort of thing.
So the past couple of shows, we've had JT Thorne and Jaya Jewell, who are students at West Coast Pro, who have gone pro. They've been part of ring crew and now they're going to be regular characters on our show. So
that's great.
It's really cool. Fantastic. And the West Coast ring is amazing. I love bumping in that thing.
Oh, yeah. The old APW ring had some spots you did not want to get slammed on. You know, Matt just had completely worn away, you know, with a padding, it completely worn away. And the wrestlers knew it, but guys like the managers, you know, that didn't get in there that much and didn't practice on it much, didn't know. And I took a couple of, you know, pretty stiff ones where I was expecting there to be padding and there pretty much was just straight wood. So, yeah, it can be kind of a wake-up call to you. And it's just dangerous. You know, but it is nice when you have a permanent place for your ring because then you can set the chairs up, you can set your lighting up, you're more in control of the lighting and all that stuff, which makes taping it, you know, much easier and all that sort of stuff. And eventually, you know, the magic bullet for all wrestling independent wrestling is to get on TV, you know, and to get, or to get some kind of regular video thing going where, you know, you can build a fan following through YouTube and some people outside of California can see what you're up to. And then you can, you know, maybe start getting noticed because, you know, once upon a time, guys like Brian Cage, this is all the stuff that he was doing, you know, and same with, you know, guys like, Daniel Bryant and so forth. They weren't doing stuff much greater than what you're doing now, and look where they are today. So, you know,
yeah. A lot of people have really gotten over in the modern era on social media. Matt Cardona, for instance. On that note, by the way, everyone should check out Full Queer's social media. Our founder, Marco Mayor, manages our Twitter page and most of our other social media.
Your ex page now.
You'll never catch me saying that. I'm sorry. No.
Yes.
Well, I'm just hoping for, you know, some of the wrestlers that came out as Mr. X back in, you know, the day, like say, hey, that's you're ruining my trademark. You're messing with my copyright.
It's prime time for a masked Mr. X to
to file suit against. Yes.
But yeah, our Full Queer YouTube channel is something we're investing in a lot right now. We've got filming by previously David Edge and now the Huckabees, who do a lot of stuff with their site Indie Dependent. So they do a ton of like filming and whatnot across Northern California, but we've actually hired them to do like multiple angles. And oh, yep, here he comes.
There's your cat. Remember, they're all cats. What's your cat again? Cat's name again?
Malcolm.
As in Malcolm Reynolds, the captain of the Serenity.
Oh, really? I was going to say you got to put him to the left hill, and he could be Malcolm in the middle.
Oh, get over here, dude. Yeah, one day Kenny Omega will grace us with her presence. We have our smallest cat is named Kenny Omega. Oh. I'd like to say that she's the greatest kitten wrestler of her generation.
Does she and Malcolm go at it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So she likes to tag team with her sister, Riho Hime.
Ah.
We thought that they were an intergender tag team, but it turns out that they're both female, but whatever.
Ah, you know, that worked for your wrestling fed also, you know, what was your main event in your last show?
The main event was the tag team gauntlet match. To crown the new number one contenders for the tag team titles. And in the finish of the match, the Monsters on a Mission, consisting of Brutal Rob Hands and Rey Kaiju Joey Yanzo, defeated, Marco Mania and Fabuloso Fabricio, Money, Power, Respect, in a most shameful manner.
But they went through several.
They defeated several opponents
first. Cutie and the Beast.
Legitimately. Cutie and the Beast, by the way, were.
Managed by him.
Managed by me. They were sort of a pet project of mine to introduce to this show on this.
Did you come up with a name? Did you come up with the name Cutie and the Beast?
No, they were already wrestling under that name.
Okay. I like it.
Is that their team at East Bay Pro?
I think they were or are the WWZ champions there, and they do a lot of stuff with Next Level.
There you go.
In Sacramento.
It sounds like you guys.
Lo Devereaux. Lo Devereaux is a real performer, let me tell you. Reese the Beast, a tremendous athlete.
You guys are really becoming kind of like the gathering spot for all these different feds, it sounds like. You know, it sounds like, you know, you've selected from all sorts of feds here in the Bay Area. Why do you think you guys are so collective like that? As
I think it's a combination of factors. One of them is, and we don't talk about this a lot, but at Full Queer, we have a policy where everyone who works every show gets paid. And at most wrestling companies out there, this is not the case. Where there's a whole tier of unpaid.
That's the other way around. If you get paid, that's the part that people are like, "Wow, I can't believe it." Or it's really lopsided. The name talent will get paid a lot, and then the lower echelon gets nothing.
So we believe very strongly in a measure of pay equity there. So everyone who works our show gets paid, including, and that includes non-wrestlers.
Yeah, people who work runners, merch, get paid. Merch, door, wrestlers that volunteer to help us collect tips between matches get a bonus.
So that makes it very easy for us to network and get new people who are interested in working with us.
Have you been able to break even doing that? Have you?
We've come very close.
Yeah, it's a challenge, but it's a new business, so we're in a phase where we're investing and trying to grow right now.
Yeah.
Right, but I don't want it to come out of your pockets. That would be sad stuff if you.
Actually have a way of rationalizing this. Do you mind if I share this?
It does come out of our pockets, to be honest.
Yeah.
But, as Ellie, I think, was about to explain.
Yeah, we're very lucky. We've both got steady jobs with good income. We don't have kids that we're taking care of.
Oh, yeah.
We've got, expenses.
Mine just turned 12, so yes.
But we're in a position that we have the know-how and we have this, savings that we've been wanting to put towards growing a business of our own. Maybe not as early as we are now, but the stars aligned, we had the opportunity and we're going for it. And we rationalize this because Ryan comes from being a lifelong hobbyist in the Magic the Gathering community. And for me, I'm a cosplayer.
God, you're a nerd.
I literally just
finished
some cosplay gear.
She's making herself an Urusei Yatsura outfit.
Yeah, anime. And I want to be able to wrestle in it too, so I'm doing double duty there, but I digress.
Her point is that
we have friends that went to San Diego Comic-Con and spent more just to get there and stay in those hotels more individually than we did combined take a loss on a wrestling show.
Even the whole expense of producing a show. We have friends who go to Disneyland and they spend more than we spend producing a show, even irrespective of any revenue that we raise.
Right.
Just staying in Disney hotels, eating Disney stuff every meal.
People have a car collection.
Some people go to the shooting range and shoot $500 worth of ammo every week. Not me. I'm not a guy at all.
but all of these things are valid hobbies, right? So if we're going to spend that much money and there's a chance for a return on that investment and we get to hire artists who we've loved and admired for years and help build and discover people within our own community and brother a bunch of our friends and give them paychecks, I feel like that's a pretty good use of our money.
That's great. What you two aren't are money marks, and that's a key thing, because I've seen a lot of
people think this is money marking,
but you haven't gone for instance, and the guy's great. I mean, he's a really nice guy who ran a wrestling fed out in Petaluma, but he went and got the Young Guns and the Young Bucks. Sorry, he got the Young Bucks on his show. This was early before they were big, and he got I'm trying to remember who the other guy was, really a pretty big name too, and he got the Petaluma Civic Auditorium.
Wow.
And he probably spent $8,000 on his show, and that just left him with no capacity to have a second show. He thought, That the adage that never works is, I'll make it up with the gate. Spending way over your budget and saying, and we have no pre-sales, or we have 50 people pre-sold, and we'll make it all up, opening night at the gate. is a difficult philosophy that I've seen lead to the ruin of a number of people financially.
So we're marketing people, we're data people, we're biz dev people, and it feels like we were able to gather enough data to make an informed decision after helping out with so many different promotions around the Bay and stuff, just like showing up and volunteering or, you know, working the door, whatever, that we had this sense that, like, you can never rely on the door. You need to, like, don't invest in the quality of your show, invest in marketing your show, but, like, never count on selling at the door tickets. Try to pre-sell as many as you can, you know?
Yeah, and you have to make sustainable investments.
Yeah.
Like, you can't, as you said, spend all the money that you could conceivably spend on running a wrestling show on a single show.
Yeah.
Because even if you book people who could be big draws, you can't count necessarily on them drawing for any specific night. As sort of happened to us in August, actually.
Yeah.
Where we didn't think about this when we booked our date, but we maybe foolishly booked a show on the same weekend as Outside Lands, which I think was actually a big competitor for us in terms of the people who we might have been able to turn out.
Yeah.
And we did okay in the end. We were really sweating our pre-sale numbers, but we were happy with our attendance.
But yeah, that can be, you know, and trying to get everything in line so that you're not competing with things like Giants games, 49er games, other wrestling events.
There were three other shows in 2 days.
That's also
within 20 miles of us. Like
West Coast Pro ran that same week.
They ran twice that same week.
And wow. Iowa ran the same day as us.
Day before.
Day before.
No, it is the same day. It was Oasis. Oasis Pro ran the day before. So actually, it was three promotions, four shows. Anyway, it was
a very packed weekend for events in the Bay Area.
And great because we got to share talent with a lot of these promotions.
Yes.
So hopefully we all saved some money on that. But like,
that's a lot of wrestling. Yeah, it's a lot of wrestling for one general area. And, you know, it's so weird because we went, you know, 3 years without there being any shows almost.
Yeah.
And now
I think that's why it's happening, actually. So many people had something like this that they wanted to do. Like, I think kind of Oasis and Folkweir have kind of emerged out of the pandemic as projects that we wanted, or maybe that I wanted to do as a passion project. And clearly something that Big Juicy wanted to do as well, opening up his place.
Did you guys do any kind of in-ring tribute to Exotic Adrian Street or make any kind of mention, 10 bell count to him?
No,
we did not.
Unfortunately, our audience wouldn't really understand that because we're trying to grow a wrestling audience through like the local community, and they're not, we don't have a lot of people who would know who that was.
Yeah, one thing that's actually really interesting about our marketing strategy and our sales strategy is that we have been focusing on locals more so than people from the greater area who were already wrestling fans.
Yeah.
And so the fact that most of our fans were not originally wrestling fans before they started watching us, they wouldn't know who Adrian Street was. And I also think that there's quite a mixed feeling in the queer community about Mr. Street, which now that you've mentioned him, maybe we should talk about.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, please.
Straight people playing gay characters in the year 2023, not on our show.
Yeah, this actually came up recently for one of our wrestlers where he was asked to perform, you know, a similar gay panic moment where he scared his opponent. I don't even remember what it was, but
it was a non-consensual kiss spot.
Okay, so he made his opponent uncomfortable by kissing him, and then because his opponent was so no homo about it, he went over dirty. And you know, none of us like to see that, really.
No.
It's kind of funny in a way, but it's also just so puerile and kind of I think we should move on as a people.
Yeah.
From that kind of cheap joke. And Adrian Street, regrettably, was pretty well known for doing that sort of thing. He saw that it got over, and I respect, you know, the hustle. Like, if you find something and it gets over, and in his time period, his approach to the business had to be what it was, because you had to find something that helped you stand out, and this is what he found. But currently, in the current year, certainly, we should not be doing that kind of thing anymore, I think.
We also had Gold Dust, you know,
And it feels different with...
Gold Dust obviously grew beyond that character, and I think has been embraced in many ways by the queer community in retrospect. And part of that also is that Dustin moved beyond Gold Dust and now performs as Dustin Rhodes himself. It's a similar look, but obviously not Gold Dust at all. And he's been very vocally supportive of the queer community. If I'm remembering correctly, he has a transgender child.
I think that's true, yes.
And so he's been very vocal about his support of the community as a result. So that's helpful, of course.
Well, good. I mean, I mean, of course, wrestling from the 80s and being something that you weren't was something that, you know, was the big thing. And now wrestling is much more about being who you actually are, you know, and amplifying that so that that character comes out in the ring as opposed to being something that you're absolutely not and just trying to pretend that you are. You know, I mean, we had everything from, as I said, Sergeant Slaughter was never in the military, and guys like Boris Zukov and Ivan Koloff, who were, you know, from Canada, and, you know, so on and so forth. Like, lots of people that, you know, George the Animal Steel was a school professor, yet, you know, played a drooling idiot in the ring, you know, and so, yeah, it, that sort of thing was just so acceptable back in the day. But I do, you know, do you feel that the performers that you work with feel kind of more liberated because they're doing something that's not, they don't have to pretend that they're something they're not? And they're able to put themselves into the character that they really believe in now.
So,
absolutely.
Can I shout out Darwin Finch for a moment? Because they're recently out as non-binary. They're the punk rock Poindexter, which is always a tongue twister for me for some reason.
And one half of the tag team Adventures in Science.
Right. And they were in our tag team gauntlet.
With the genderless adventuress Laura Frazier.
This is a new, like, organically formed within Full Queer tag team, by the way. And they found each other because they're both non-binary and they both have these, like, geeky personas and they happen to have the same color gear in their bags.
That's fun.
But it was a match made in heaven.
It was a match made in heaven.
They work amazingly well together. They have great chemistry. Great physics too.
But so Darwin wore a dress to the ring for the first time. And I can tell that this was, you know, a big step for them in expressing who they are in the ring, and that there are promotions where they wouldn't feel safe doing that or possibly would be dissuaded from doing that by those in charge. So I'm working on gear for them for Folsom. I'm so excited. I cannot wait to show everybody what this, I mean, what we came up with is awesome. So, I mean, yeah, I think that's like one example. We're always trying to find ways to get people over in a way that makes sense for who they are. And if somebody doesn't have a strong enough personality and they're green and they're still developing their character, we try to foist gimmicks onto them. That we hope makes sense.
Sure, absolutely.
And at least then we can book them that way. It makes sense for what we need from them.
I think what you were saying, though, about the way that people perform more as themselves now is true, though. And especially, I think that's been the product of the social media era.
Yeah.
Looks like cat number two is working her way into your...
Oh, yes. Riho Hime. We have another cat now? This is Riho Hime. She was on AEW.
Nice.
I mean, seriously, when they were at the Cow Palace, when they were at the Cow Palace, Riho had a match with Toni Storm like the week before Revolution. And I had a sign that said, I named my cat after Riho.
And she
was on the sign. I put her picture on the sign. And so that got on TV and everybody was tagging me. My phone blew up. Ellie, your cat's on TV.
Maybe she'll give us more ratings for our show. So
I sure
grab her and put her on. But sorry to interrupt, but I saw her peeking her way through there. So continue. People performing as themselves.
Yeah.
In the social media era, you know, people have direct access to a wrestler's thoughts because wrestlers are so accustomed to sharing themselves on social media.
And at this point, if you want to get over, you kind of have to use social media. I hate Twitter, but I have an account and I occasionally post random crap because
it's so expected.
Yeah, I don't think I could. Like, I'm just getting started. I need to do everything I can to get over with and find.
I'm old. I use Facebook. I'm old. I use Facebook.
We do too.
What are you gonna say about it? You know, I've been and I do have a Twitter account, but I never use it because thanks to Trump. I just hate it. Musk doesn't make me fall in love with him either. So talk a little bit about your upcoming show and tell the fans about what to expect.
That's right. So our upcoming show is totally different from a normal full queer show.
Not for the faint of heart.
It is not for the faint of heart. We are producing our biggest show of the year. And this is going to be our biggest show ever, of course.
Biggest show to date.
And it's at the Folsom Street Fair, September 24th, 2023. That's a Sunday in San Francisco, California. We will be right off of Folsom Street itself, I think.
Yes, we're on 11th this year. 11th. We're on 11th between Folsom and Harrison. And if you check out our social media, we do have a poster that
there's
I drew.
That's on the
poster.
I drew this poster based on Attack of the 50-Foot Woman.
Yes, I've seen that. Yeah, that's hilarious.
So,
the poster
is,
of course, a reference to the 50-Foot Woman, and it's a reference to the fact that this is the 40th Folsom Street Fair.
40th anniversary.
Which means that it has the Roman numerals XL.
Extra large.
So near and dear to my heart. I am myself XL.
So it's a perfect homage for the 50-Foot Woman. And we also get to feature our biggest get ever, talent-wise, Ms. Giselle Shaw. She will be main eventing our Folsom Street Fair show against our current champion, Brooke Havoc. Giselle Shaw is a very prominent performer right now on Impact Pro Wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
And she is one of the most famous transgender wrestlers in the game at the moment.
Wow.
She was recently, unfortunately, the subject of some drama involving one of the Steiners, who we won't go into. But she's been very excited about working with us and coming out to make time in her schedule to stop by San Francisco. I think she's flying from Tennessee the night before.
Yes.
To work for us Sunday. And then Monday, she's working somewhere else. She's doing a taping.
Yeah, she's got a taping in, I believe, Toronto.
Wow.
Or maybe she lives in Toronto and needs to get home in time for something else. Anyway.
She lives a very busy schedule.
She's going to be in San Francisco for less than 12 hours for us.
Wow, just for you guys.
Yes. And I can't say how much that means to me. Obviously, I'm super inspired by Giselle because I, you know, drew her as the 40-foot woman or whatever. But I think that's just like, that's the tip of the iceberg. We've got a bunch of local businesses that are sponsoring various matches for us.
That's great.
We've been very active trying to hit up local sponsors.
Yes.
And also some less local sponsors.
Yes.
Watch our social media. We'll be announcing some new sponsorships soon that we just closed today.
This being a nonprofit street fair, And us having a very, very limited budget, we're trying to do as much as we can as far as like fundraising in advance of things. So we're probably going to have a couple of beer busts, maybe some bake sales. We do a bit of that before our big expensive shows too. So
I think we should mention, let's see, there are some sponsors we can mention. Paxton Gate is a local, what are they?
Oddities and Curiosities Shop?
Yeah, they have a little bit of everything. They have some taxidermy.
If you're wondering where to buy an actual human skull,
they might know.
No, they have one. I've seen it. I mean,
is that legal?
It's interesting to see what that costs.
Wow.
Thousands of dollars for a human skull makes sense.
They're sponsoring us. They're obviously a perfect fit for all the oddities of Folsom. Another sponsor that we recently signed with is Death Guild, a goth club that meets, I believe, once a month.
Once a week. Every Monday at DNA Lounge. Yeah.
They're now sponsoring Night Court, Jekyll's the Freak, and Dave Reckoning.
Nice.
And Five and Diamond is a small independent clothing designer that's based out of the Mission. And they are sponsoring our new Lone Star champion, Rosie Fingers, to get a whole makeover. So she's going to look like a post-apocalyptic Mad Max Barbie, probably. it's going to be awesome. We're all really excited to see how that turns out because their clothes are so cool and so wrestling.
That's incredible. No, it's great. You guys have made some wonderful, you know, progress since I talked to you last. And we're almost out of time for this evening. So why don't you throw out your plugs and social media stuff, and hopefully our fans will come see you at the Folsom Street Fair.
Yeah, so that's the Folsom Street Fair show, September 24th. We'll be putting on a 7+ hour show. That's free. You know, it's a free show. It's an outdoor fair. That said, it is 18+ only, adults only. Don't bring your kids. You can bring grandma, but you should warn her what she's about to see.
Google Folsom Street Fair, or if you've got Safe Search turned on and you can't turn it off, you can also look on Flickr to get an idea of what you will see at the Folsom Street Fair. And if you don't like what you see, maybe sit this one out and wait till it's on our YouTube channel.
Yeah, which some of the material is postable on YouTube.
Yeah.
And you will be able to see some of it subsequently.
Fantastic.
So, and you can look up our YouTube right now. We've got all of our previous shows except for the most recent one from August 13th. And those videos are going to start hitting our scheduler this weekend. So
that's fantastic. So
mine won't be up for a while, but my debut match will be on there very soon.
Great.
Our links at beacons.ai/folkweer.
Oh, we sound like an actual commercial.
Hey, that's what this is all about, folks. Thank you so much for being on the show. Sorry we had such crazy mix-ups, but it'll all work out in the end. And looking forward to having you guys on the show again soon.
Awesome. We will too.
You guys have a great night. Good night, everybody.
Bye. Good night.